What's going on, everybody? Today, I thought we could take a quick look at what I've done to modify my splitboard boots. Now, there are two different types of interfaces for a splitboard. Obviously, they both start at your feet, and they're either going to be a standard soft boot, like this one, you know, standard boot that everybody that's riding a snowboard rides with. It gives you that nice snowboarding feel that we've all come to know and love. It allows us to walk around easily, with a little more flex than a ski boot. And, you know, it works great for snowboarding. And the other way to do it is a hard boot. This is the alternative interface for a splitboarding solution, I would say. This particular boot is a Dynafit boot. It is an AT ski boot, meaning it's made for touring, so it goes up and down like this, as well as the downhill. And just for reference, I'll show you the board that I'm using. My split board is this Older Jones Solution with Spark R&D Dyno DH bindings. This is obviously a specific binding for hard boots. I use Vole canted pucks. And if you want to learn more about what a split board is, how it works, and some more specifics on this board, check out the video I made for that up in that link. Let's get to it. So, this is a ski boot. Now, when you're skiing, you turn by moving left or right on your edges. Your edges are on the sides of you. Whereas on a snowboard boot, you have to tilt forward and back, your toe edge and your heel edge. So obviously that is a huge inherent difference with how boots are designed. Because of that, a ski boot has a very rigid, stiff shell. And that allows you to move medially or in towards the inside of your body or laterally outside and roll onto those edges nice and easily with basically no flex at all inside and outside. Well, we're trying to use this thing on a snowboard, so obviously that's not going to work for us. And before I get into this, I should say I would not recommend modifying any type of ski boot. Don't do it, it's a bad idea, it'll void your warranty, it obviously destroys the structural integrity of it, and you're cutting into a $400, $500, $800 boot, I don't know. It's probably not a good idea. So yeah, don't do it. But what I've done is I've taken this Dynafit Winter Guide boot. The popular boots, if you look on forums, are Dynafit TLT6s, Atomic Backlands, a couple others. One company, Phantom, actually recently made their own hard boot specific for splitboarding. And I think it uses Atomic Backland kind of like as the base, but I have never used it. I've heard great things about it. This is where I'm at. This is what I've done so far. So this is the outside of the boot right here. The outside of the boot, meaning your lateral flex towards the outside of your body. As you can see, I have three holes drilled into the side of it. This allows the cuff portion to flex more outwardly. What I did to drill these holes was I used obviously a drill with a 1-inch spade bit. There are different options. There's hole saws, other things like that you could use. I used that. Before you do this, I would also, before you never do this, let's back up, never do this. It took me 3 years to get to this point, 3 years of modifications, starting small and going more and more and more. And I'm starting with this in this video, but this is not where I actually started my modifications. And I drilled three holes. I started out with two and then I put a third one in the middle because I felt like I needed a little more flex. After I've drilled these holes, I like to use this style hooked blade. It fits into any regular razor blade holder, and I'm able to kind of round the edges to get rid of any plastic. You want to get it as rounded as possible, keep it in a, you know, make it nice. I also added holes on the inside for more medial flex. So this flexes towards the inside of your body. Again, I started with less. I started with three on the top and then added two more because I personally wanted more flex on the ride down. And then this is also 1-inch holes. I measured everything out many, many, many times before drilling because you don't want to screw it up. The first modification I made to my boots was this hole in the back. I unscrewed this metal, I took it out, and I used a Dremel rotary style tool, something like this, with a bit that's made for cutting out metal. So I was able to enlarge that hole, and that's actually where your top buckle clips in. See this kind of, this piece? That goes into that hole, and that allows you to flex more forward and backwards. So, it allows me to get more of this type of flex forwards and back when I'm going onto my heel and toe edge. Another modification I did is I took off the power strap that typically goes around the top, and I also cut about a half inch off of the whole top collar on both sides. And in order to do that, I use these Stanley Fat Max style clippers. They're great, they're easy. And again, I use the curved razor to kind of make a nice clean line. In addition to that, I just moved my top buckle up. And those are the only modifications I have personally made to my boots. If you go online, you can find on different forums, you can find people that have cut down on the medial side to get more inward flex. You can find people that have done that on the lateral side as well. Also different modifications to the tongue area, and honestly, all sorts of crazy things, which again, I wouldn't recommend. And again, if you do it, you're ruining a boot. You have no idea how it's gonna perform. You're never gonna be able to sell this to anybody, and it basically becomes a piece of trash if it doesn't work for you. So, why would you do this? Why would you modify a boot that's made to be super hard and stiff for skiing to work for splitboarding? And like, why would you take a stiff boot and make it a not stiff boot? And that's kind of the question that everybody always has. And here's my comments for why I did it and why I like it. First off, if you're splitboarding, you're going to be touring most of the day. I say generally like 80% here on the East Coast when I'm splitboarding in the Adirondacks and places like that in New York. You're below tree line 99% of the time. You're doing hard maneuvers up steep embankments, through river drainages, all sorts of things with boulders, logs, rocks, you know, everything. And it's really nice to be able to tour in something that's made to tour. This clipping in to the toe piece gives you really nice range of motion when you're touring, and it feels good. You're able to pull up and then drag it forward as you're supposed to on like a set of AT skis. And obviously on a splitboard, we're doing the same exact thing. So really, it tours really well. Also, because it's such a stiff boot, even after I've done this stuff, it gives me a lot of edge control if I'm on a steeper, harder face and going sideways when I'm making my kick turns, just going up the side of a face. It makes it really easy to grip that edge and stick it into the icy surface that we're on. So that's another reason that I like it. Also, it's very, in my mind, it's very comfortable. It allows me to not only go forward like that, but when you're in tour mode, you can go back quite a bit too, which allows your ankle to move in nearly its full range of motion, which is a little different than if you're in a snowboard boot, where you're going to get that forward motion because of the binding, but your ankle is still stuck. Your ankle's in this boot and it cannot flex at all. Whereas this boot, your ankle can flex forwards and backwards because of how it's designed. The thing is, this boot, in my mind, has never gotten to the exact same level as a soft boot for the ride down. But because of how long the tour and the skinning and everything going up is, I'm okay to sacrifice a little bit of the ride quality for a overall, in my mind, better day because the tour is so long. You know, that's the type two part. The type one part, the fun ride down, it's still fun for me. And because of these modifications that I've made, this boot rides very similarly to a stiff soft boot, but it's still stiffer than a stiff soft boot. So if you are thinking about ever doing this, and you should not, know that pretty much no matter what you do to a hard boot, it's still going to be much stiffer than a standard snowboard boot, even the stiff style free riding boots. But it to me, it works really nicely. It also accepts a fully auto crampon because of the toe and heel welts. Very nice when you're doing mountaineering style splitboarding. That's pretty much it. Again, it's fairly simple tool-wise. A drill with a spade bit, whatever size hole you deem good. I used 1 inch, people use 1.5 inches. People go more, people go less. It depends on the flex you're trying to achieve. Some Stanley multi-cutters. These work really well for cutting through the plastic. Basic screwdriver, interchangeable bit, so I have my flat, my Phillips, whatever I need for taking apart the belt, the buckles, and moving things around. And then also a hooked razor blade, which goes into a razor handle. Don't use it like this, you're gonna cut yourself. This allows me to just clean up the edges and everything on all of the modifications that I've made. Lastly, the Dremel rotary tool. To do anything else that you might wanna do, you can clean up the edges, you can cut through the metal portion in the back. So that's the modifications I've made to my hard boot splitboard boots. I started with this rear, made it a larger hole so I get more front and back flex, more toe and heel flex. I went in to the medial side. I started with 3. I ended up adding more after an entire season of riding. And again, I started with 2 on the lateral side. And then after a whole nother season of riding, I added 1 more because I wanted a little more flex. And most recently, I cut down the collar about 1/2 inch on both sides just to get a little more forward flex when I'm on my toe edge, because I like to keep my rear knee a little more bent than my front knee when I'm in like chunky crud, mashed potato stuff, when I want to lean back if it's powdery. A lot of times that's how my stance is, so that's what works for me. None of these modifications are going to work for everybody. None of these modifications are recommended. So don't do them, but I hope it gave you some good ideas. Okay. Thanks for watching. If you liked this, please like and subscribe for more similar videos on cool splitboarding stuff, biking stuff, and all that sort of thing. And also, if you've done any modifications, let me know what you've done, because I'm always looking for new and different ways to improve my boarding and my boot setup.